see the Sydney in Iraq, to the people there in Iran and Sydney. But we don't want a solution. They want the problem. Go right ahead.
You have to remember Cecil Rhodes and the Secret Society take over the world, and Milner executed it in the early 1900s after Rhodes died, and they really ran British foreign policy from, you know, around 1901-02 up to 1939-ish. And they did, just as you said, and Sir Percy Cox was the one who drew up all that stuff, as he did. And in addition to what you said, he also created the country of Kuwait deliberately to keep Iraq away from an outlet to the sea. You know, he wanted not only to divide up Iraq so that you'd have these consternations and battles, but he wanted to prevent this new country of Iraq from having a direct outlet to the sea, which would cause more problems and more dependency upon the British. And they did the same thing in Nigeria. In Nigeria and all these places where the British and their colonies in Africa, you say, okay, let's have these boundaries here. All right, we got the Hausa in the north, the Muslims. We're going to put these Christians in the River State in the south. We got the Igbo and the Yoruba, and that'll work pretty good. Constant civil war. Okay, I know the British do that sort of thing. So Percy Cox did that in 1921-ish. And I put this, you know, I put these things in my books, like Now is the Dawning of the New Age, New World Order, back in 1991. You know, I put this stuff in there, and people don't read it, so whatever. But anyway, so you have the situation where you have them battling each other, the Sunni and the Shia. All right, so we come in and we say, oh, democracy. All right, well, what happens with democracy? Well, that's sort of majority rule, and the Shia, they love that because they're, you know, the majority population. If you include the Kurdistan and so forth, the Shia are like 42-45%, and the Sunni are 40%. But if you separate out the Kurds, then it's even more. But the point is, the Shia love this because they were the minority population. Now, what do you think they're going to do when they get majority control? They're going to get back at those dirty Sunnis. It's revenge time. And so, you know, lo and behold, who could have thought that they exclude people? I mean, that's what the Shia have been doing, and that's what they've, this all has built in frustration on the part of the Sunnis. Okay, so there's the lay of the land. So you got this, the Sunnis have been oppressed for year after year after year by Maliki, right? Lots of resentment building up. So guess what happens? All right, so Assad isn't doing what he should do, so we have a revolution, right? We create a revolution against Assad. I mean, everything was sort of okay. Okay, he's a dictator, he's an evil guy, but we deal with dictators all the time.
Wait a minute, you're going from Iraq down into Syria where we have Assad. Okay, go ahead.
All right, but these jihadists, Baghdadi and his ISIS group, have come from Syria into Iraq. Okay, so I'm backtracking here. I'm going backtracking. All right, now, what did we do in Syria? We created this crisis, even though, you know, Assad wasn't murdering people right and left. He's an evil guy, but he's not murdering people. And so that's why, to get rid of him, we had to have a revolution in Libya, right? I mean, there was no real reason to have a revolution in Libya, but we funded. The new people come in on the east. They have al-Qaeda mixed in there. Now, remember, there's the good al-Qaeda and the bad al-Qaeda. We, you know, the 100 al-Qaeda in Afghanistan, they're the bad al-Qaeda. But the al-Qaeda everywhere else, we seem to, you know, get along with, maybe even help a little.
Well, we're going to go to a break. Basically, you have to have a revolution in Libya so you can get weapons so you can send them over to Syria.
Syria,
that's
right.
About. We'll be back in just a moment with Dr. Dennis Cuddy. But basically, the average American doesn't understand what's going on because they're constantly lied to.
The airport tonight, buy some one-way tickets on a southbound flight.
Dr. Kelly, you go right ahead and pick up the story.
Okay, so you have the revolution in Libya, and it's really important that three top al-Qaeda members become in the official new Libyan government, one particularly in charge of border control, and I've mentioned that in the past, so I won't belabor it. But the point is, with him in charge of border control, then you can slip these weapons easily with our knowledge, with the knowledge of Ambassador Stevens, in Libya, across Egypt, with the approval and okie dokie of the Muslim Brotherhood, and you ship them all the way up to Syria on the one hand. This is the general weapons, you know, the AK-47s, that sort of stuff. But you send deliberately the anti-tank weapons through Egypt up to Hamas. So when Israel is going to try to respond to Hamas's launching of rockets, they put on the brake screech because they now see that Hamas has anti-tank weapons. So that was that. And then Morsi steps in and says, ah, I will negotiate. He's the head at that time of Egypt. And he's doing okay. He's doing his bidding. But then he gets a little pushy. A little pushy. He starts imprisoning people and torturing them in the same prison that Hosni Mubarak did. And so he had to be put down. Okay, so we create this situation in Syria where you have these rebels. Now, just like in Libya, here comes Al-Qaeda. Duh, surprise. You know, we know this is going to happen. So you have the moderate rebels who are simply tired of Assad, you know, being the minority Shiite, persecuting the majority Sunni in Syria. And so what happens is the moderates just have their own, you know, revolution. We're tired of this. And then here comes in Al-Qaeda. No, thank you. But they come in because, you know, all peoples are welcome to try and overthrow Assad. All right. Well, what lo and behold, this is the more recent emergence of ISIS and Baghdadi. So they're in Syria and fighting. All right, but we, and apparently deliberately, do not give enough aid to either group. You know, we don't give enough weapons and so forth to the rebels to actually remove Assad, right, because we want to have this consternation and conflict. And so they're both still slaughtering each other right and left. All right, now, if you're ISIS and you see that you're not getting enough weapons to actually overthrow Assad, what do you think you do? What's the logical thing? I say, well, why are we getting beat up, killing ourselves here? We'll just go across the border into Iraq, right? I mean, why not? We'll go over there and help our Sunni brethren. And now, why would we do that? Well, number one, we know they're oppressed. Number two, there's a ton of money in the Sunni northern cities, you know, Mosul and Tikrit, where Saddam Hussein was from, and then further south in Fallujah. And we're not going to have any resistance. Because the Sunnis there, even including the Sunnis in the Iraqi army, they're not going to fight us. I mean, why would the Sunnis in the Iraqi army fight us when they're being oppressed and their people are being oppressed by Maliki? You know why? Okay, so they said, hey, this is easy. We're not going to keep getting slaughtered here in Syria. We'll just go into Iraq and basically take over the place because all of those members of the Sunnis in the national Iraqi army are going to come over to our side, which they do, right? Okay, so you easily take, and that's why the whole thing is speedy. And that's why, you know, Hillary's sitting there in a race to the bottom of stupidity versus Condoleezza Rice, because you know what they're going to do. You know it's going to be fast because they're not going to have any resistance in the Sunni area of Iraq because the ISIS is Sunni themselves, right? So they come in there. Now, what are you going to do if you have any intelligence at all? You're going to grab all the money, right? So one of the first things to do is they go into the bank at Mosul. They get hundreds of millions of dollars out of the bank, right?
Hold that thought. Hold that thought. We're going to be back here in just a moment with Dr. Cuddy. Well, Dr. Cuddy is simply pointing out that certainly why we have the Sunni radicals moving into Iraq, and they go into the bank there in Mosul. They go to the major bank. They steal $50 million to help fund this whole revolutionary movement. And so the Sunnis want an independent nation. The Shias want an independent nation. But we're not going to suggest that. We don't want a logical solution. We want conflict, because that's, of course, how that you're able to direct the course of civilization. And this goes all the way back to the end of the First World War, when the British specifically set up a society with both the Sunni and the Shia and the Kurds, so it would always be unstable. It's unstable today, and you're not going to get a solution because they don't want a solution. They want the problem. Dr. Cuddy, go ahead.
What you have is they move from city to city to city in the Northwest, which are Sunni controlled. And so the latest total was they have something like $425 million and bullion and so forth that they've ripped off from the various banks. And so now with $425 million, you can buy a lot of weapons. Hey, maybe even a dirty nuclear weapon. I mean, look, think of what Baghdadi can do with a dirty bomb, right? You think Israel had problems before? Just wait. Okay, so Now they come in and they got a ton of money and they have an easy way to go up to Baghdad. All right, so why is that happening? I mean, why is the paralegal allowing that to happen? Well, there's several possible reasons. Number one, maybe the paralegal, just like they did with Sisi against Morsi in Egypt, maybe they want to allow this to put a little pressure on Maliki to do that which they had wanted them to. See, Morsi got in trouble because he was implementing too much in Egypt of the Sharia law. He wasn't including the secularists, the young students, and the paralegal doesn't like that. They don't want any really strong national leader. They want sort of this mushy thing. Like Brzezinski said, Turkey is our model. So we all, can't we, Rodney King, can't we all get along? Let's all be inclusive. All right, so here comes Sisi in Egypt, and he puts down Morsi and arrest him and so forth. So it may be some of that going on. They want to pressure Maliki to start making nice with the Sunnis. However, there's another possibility. Another possibility is if you have these radicals like ISIS in Syria, if you can lure them into this situation coming up against the Shia in Baghdad, then you can do the same thing there that you were doing in Syria, right? Have another bloodbath. You know, have ISIS fighting the Shiites and the national army, the ones who were left, the Shia, and the national army of Iraq, and get them to slaughter each other all over the place, which is, you know, one of the favorite mechanisms that the paralegal has for, you know, controlling people.
And, you know, it's amazing. It's, I'm reading an article today talking about how the road to Baghdad is lined with the, yep, with the headless corpses of this, of the thousands of soldiers have been beheaded.
Yep.
800,000 civilians have fled. Ladies and gentlemen, this is happening today. It is happening with your tax money, funding both sides. Go ahead.
Right. Okay, so what's Obama doing? Well, he's studying the matter. And his problem is multifold. I'm rather suspicious that all this delays. It's sort of like if it's incompetence with Obamacare. I really don't think it's incompetence. I think it's sort of by design. And so I suspect all this delay and, golly shucks, we're caught by surprise is all a farce. Because now he'll say, well, we're studying the matter. Well, studying the matter with a rapidly advancing force is not a good idea ordinarily unless it's planned. And so what you have is he said, well, golly, you know, we don't want boots on the ground. Maybe, no, we can't use airstrikes because if we try and strike, say, an ISIS leader in a house, they're going to have civilians around them, and so if we drop a drone, a bomb, and we blow up the house to get the ISIS leader, you know, the next thing we'll know on Al Jazeera, there'll be pictures of all these little children's bodies blown apart by American bombs, and that won't look too good. See, so they're using that sort of scenario. And so that they say, limits us. See, we're limited, right? Well, what's the result? The result is like Syria. You're going to have this sort of standoff bloodbath with the Shia, the national army, facing from the southwest, you know, all the people in the southwest and the Basra and so forth, the majority population. Now, they're, you know, they don't want to get beheaded, right? So they're going to put up some resistance, right? And so they're going to be fighting ISIS back and forth, you know, just like the bloodbath in Syria. You're going to have the bloodbath in Iraq. And that all works just like the Igbo against the Yoruba in Nigeria. You have the bloodbath in the Sudan. You have the bloodbath, you know, the bloodbath all over the place. And that way you debilitate people and tire them out and wear them down until they all say uncle and do what the paralegal wants, which is the goal to begin with.
And ladies and gentlemen, basically, the Middle East was stable before, of course, September 11, 2011. If you wonder what really happened that day, go open the Internet and watch Building 7 come down, a typical controlled demolition. Somebody killed 3,000 people that day so we could justify going in there and creating the chaos, which, of course, is consuming the Middle East today.